check the website on a regular basis, all right? And exam side, business support. So we're talking about the application itself. So when you fill out the application will ask you where you want to take the exam. And it will list the area business ports. If you know that, or if you have preference for a particular port, select that port. It doesn't have to be the port right then and there. It can be the port of your choice. So there will be scroll down bar, and you'll just select a port. And for example, in my case, when I was registering, I registered in Seattle. I took my license, my exam in Miami, right? At the time when I registered, I didn't have, of course, the scroll down option because it was all paper-based. So I had to go through this administrative process of change, which was kind of pain because I was worried that the information will be sent late, that the bureaucracy process will somehow fail me. So it was stress. If you know that you're going to be somewhere else, please make sure the port you select is the port where you plan to be during the time of the exam. All right, now the conduct. All right, so now that we have this computer-based system, right, we also need to be mindful that the system itself is, oops, no, thank you. No server needed. There is the electronic exam, right? The gateway to the electronic exam is here. If you enter all the information, you'll be taken to the electronic exam. This is the sample one. Should be exact replica of what you should see by the time you arrive to the customs broker license exam site. But you need to be mindful that this type of setting is the screen-based instead of bubble-based. But even though you're looking at the screen itself, you're still allowed to use written reference material. So if you bring and interpretations have changed over time too. It used to be the time when customs used to officially announce that you may only bring what's necessary. So that includes the directives, that includes the Code of Federal Regulations, that includes the Harmonized Tariff Schedule of the United States. What's the issue with that? Then there was an issue, can I make my notes on those papers, right? So customs said, okay, you may write a little bit. And I'm going back to like early 2000s when they used to publish those notices saying how much you can bring. Eventually customs has relaxed the rule to say, okay, you may bring pretty much anything as long as it's not an electronic form. Once you have that situation, you also have to ask yourself, okay, now if I can bring anything which is not an electronic form, which is paper based, I have to develop some kind of balance, because by the time, and I have the estimates on, I posted the estimates on the web page, let's see, over here, so. Yeah, so I kind of did a calculation of how much paper you need to bring, right? So your total space requirement is, and this is probably more now, right? But just necessary stuff, we're talking about the bare bones stuff, is over 2,500, right? So that's a lot, especially for people who are not very strong people. Then you have you may bring other reference materials, but you have to be mindful that if you bring the whole library with you, First of all, you may be out of space. Number two, you only have limited time to answer a question. So by the time you start flipping through your references, you may be sandbagging yourself and not allowing yourself enough sufficient time or the short enough time to answer the question. So you have to strike a right balance. How you strike a right balance, we'll talk about this in a bit. Moving on. So that's the materials. The electronic stuff now, and this has been an update. I had to update this portion since the last time, because one of the individuals I've spoken with, he brought a watch, and one of the proctors said, "Hey, listen, why do you need a watch? You do not need a watch, even though it's just simple non-electronic stuff designed to give you feedback on time. You don't need that because you now have a computer screen, and because you have a computer screen, you now are able to time yourself based on that computer." So whether this policy is all across, I'm not certain. The argument on my end would be it shouldn't be the policy, because first of all, the watch or the clock itself is something that you use to time yourself with throughout the preparation. So first of all, you are familiar with the time. Number two, you have a timer, and that timer you can control yourself. With the computer timer, on the other hand, you have no control of it. It is set up automatically to run by the software. So that may, if you design it in such a way where you time yourself, let's say my suggested time period per question would be 3 minutes on average, right? So if you set up a timer, right, 3 minutes, right? So you done this question 3 minutes, then you reset the timer, you have no capability, same capability doing using the computer. The issue with that is that the same argument that did allow you to use a watch to time yourself has been taken away to your disadvantage, and that's not fair, because it's not how much you know or how well you know. It's simply serves as a distractant. So we'll wait to see what goes on to that. I haven't seen any official position on that. I think it was more on a case-by-case basis, depending on the site. But keep that in mind. You may be forced not to use the watch. Non-scientific calculators, those are helpful. In fact, I would argue, given the fact that you have 3 minutes on average per exam question, that's your goal. You need it because you have valuations questions, right, where you have to calculate the duty and you have to calculate fractions, right? Those things take time. So if you were taking a math class, I would understand that, right? But this is not a math class. This is the class on customs customs broker license. So you're wasting time on division subtraction would be kind of arbitrary, wouldn't you think? So I haven't seen anyone being denied the non-scientific calculator, at least yet. thank God this is still around. All right, number of questions. So we have 80 questions. We have 5 answer choices, A, B, C, D, or E. The rule is single best answer rule, and the way the single best answer rule works is that there may be more than one answer, but there is always one better answer. At least that's what customs examiners claim to be. Some of you may probably know that I run appeal classes, and the whole purpose of the appeal class is to show that there is the single best answer rule doesn't work all the time. Now, of course, there is no penalties for picking incorrect answer. So if you run out of time, your best option is to guess to make sure that you at least stand a chance of getting the right answer. Do not leave, do not leave anything blank. With electronic exam, this becomes ever more important because you have to develop a methodology not to leave anything out. The reason for that is because on the screen, when you are forced to jump from question to question, one of the things that you need for yourself to decide when you, the moment you sit at the exam is how you're going to start answering questions. Where are you going to start? My recommendation is always start with the easiest stuff, which would be the Code of Federal Regulations. Let me get that. So it would be CFR, which is non-valuation. Then go to the classification. And then go to CFR, which is valuation. It's not because it's the hardest, it's because it's usually the fact pattern is the longest for those. And those traditionally take more time. Sometimes there is a hybrid. There is a hybrid between evaluation and classification. So in order to establish how much duties you need to deposit, which is part of the evaluation, you need to classify the product first, right? In that case, I would suggest as you have your classification book out, the HTS-US Harmonized Tariff Schedule of the United States, you also tackle this. But get the easiest ones first. The reason is I would feel very much upset, and I would think most of you would agree with me, if you would exhaust your time on a difficult question while the easy question out there that you could have gotten, you simply ran out of time and you couldn't get, right? So that's one of the things that I think you need to decide. And as we talk about all those 80 questions and how you're going to tackle them, right? Because the way the customs broker exam is presented, it's all over the place. Yes, customs examiners try to make sure that this is this type of stuff is in somewhat methodological manner, right? But even if you look at some of those questions, they are not what they appear to be. For example, I saw the question on foreign trade zones in the warehouses section. I saw the fees question in the free trade agreements section, right? So basically, that means that in order to stick to this methodology, and this methodology is designed to make sure that you maximize your efficiency of time, in order for you to do that, you simply have to jump from one page to another, right? It used to be easy as you flip through the paper, but now you also have to keep track on a computer. And this is something for you to keep in mind. All right, now let me, so I, as we talk about the exam, I also wanted to, let me see if I can get a student on a call, because that would allow me to also talk about the most recent experience, which just took place on the last exam. Just a second.